Hey guys, welcome to the LT Brings the Heat podcast. We're your hosts, Sean Laird and Adam Heisler, where we talk about baseball and sports performance. With topics ranging from coaching, business, and player development, our goal is to bring you a no BS approach to development in baseball and sports performance. Hope you guys enjoy. Let's rock and roll.
Hey guys, special episode today. Me and Adam are going to talk shop. As you're going to hear here in a little bit, there's some things that we want to cover, some things around the facility and kind of talking shop a little bit. We're kind of going to dive in a little bit about both of our Adam's throwing program coming up, as well as the Velo program at Laird's training. Kind of dive into some details about it, why we do what we do, certain things that we adjust on. There's going to be some good knowledge in here. And Adam, is there anything else on there that really stands out? You think you want to kind of summarize right here?
Yeah, one thing we dissect is there a difference between a baseball and a softball swing? So mm-hmm. I think we both agree on kind of where we're going to go from that standpoint. Just really lock in, load, and listen, and just kind of see your views on everything and make everything start. Let your eyes be the tells. Like, and be your own scout, basically. Am I watching two different swings or is it the same swing? Compare them side by side, and you'll be able to tell. What about you? Is there anything else that stood out from this one?
Yeah, so – we kind of dive into instruction, and we kind of dive into hitting and pitching instruction and I'm going to drop some stuff and I'm going to piss some people off. Like, you hear me saying it in a little bit, but like, I don't like private one-on-one instruction, and I talk about why I don't. And I say, like, hey, if you're getting results from it and it's doing really well, keep doing what you're doing. Don't change things. But I have some certain philosophies, and I have, you know, these last 10 to 12 years of doing kind of lessons, you know, part-time and all the way into full-time over the last 6 years, of why I believe semi-private training is best for kids, and why I believe for the growth and development, they need to be around other people and push themselves to another level. And that's something I'm really glad I got to harp on and kind of got to talk on here. And I know Adam is done a lot of similar stuff. We have a similar attitude toward things. And if you guys disagree, that's fine. But what we're saying is the results are completely different in that atmosphere. And that's the atmosphere we want to create. We want to put kids in a position for success. And I'm really excited for people to kind of listen to this and kind of get some feedback here.
But yeah, we dive in pretty good on just kind of the cultures of Laird's training and the high school heat, just to what goes on in there, what the atmosphere is like. And we kind of tell our stories about what we're seeing from these semi-privates in the group training. And I personally think we're kind of ahead of the curve here. And I wouldn't be surprised if more and more people start doing this in the near future.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, guys. Well, hey, this is gonna be a great episode. A lot of knowledge bombs, a lot of stuff, good stuff for parents, players, and coaches. So if you guys enjoy this episode, please give us that 5-star review, and here we go. Hey guys, welcome to another episode. Today we're gonna have a talk shop day today. Me and Adam are gonna sit on here and we're gonna kind of talk about what's going on in our worlds, and you know, the differences that we've got and what we got planned for the fall. And also, we're gonna address a couple of things that kind of been on our minds the last week or so. But what's going on down in Alabama, Adam?
Nothing too much, man. We're kind of just getting back into the swing of things. Fall ball's about to kick off here probably within the next couple of weeks. So you're starting to see the ones trickle back in to kind of get ready for that fall season. We've got two new programs we're going to be launching here starting next week as well. Some of the youth affiliate teams in Mobile are starting their practices this past week. So we had the month of August to kind of relax, catch up a little bit from our strenuous summers, but now we're ready to kick off and go. And what's going on with you? What you up to?
Well, we are in full swing off season right now. Bulls-wise, I don't coach fall in the Bulls. A lot of our guys are getting ready to start fall ball here this coming month. Actually, now we're already in September. Jeez, it's popping fast. But they're getting ready to start, and they'll play about 6 weekends. And they basically do Friday, Saturday, Sunday every weekend for that 6 weeks. I think there might be 7 weeks at times. But when it comes to LT, man, we're actually getting ready to start our Velo program here this coming week, about a week from yesterday, actually. So we're really excited about that. And, you know, we kind of do, and I know we talked about this a little bit before, and I'll kind of touch on it. Like, our Velo program, we usually run a fall one for 6 to 8 weeks. Usually it's right around the 6-week mark, 7-week mark, because we want to try to – what I saw a lot in the past is guys would take that whole month of August off, and they would start into fall ball, and they're not in shape like they were in the summer, or they're not doing the things they're supposed to be into the summer. And so we started doing a fall Velo program instead, as opposed to a winter and kind of early, late spring. We're still doing that, you know, but adding that fall. And we've had a ton of results. And actually last year we had probably, I think it was our biggest results in a camp ever in the fall. And a lot of it was because of guys just doing the right things and, you know, understanding how to use their body, understanding how to put force into the ground. So I'm really pumped about that, but it's something that I really enjoy doing. It's probably my favorite thing I'd like to do. My hitting lessons, I would say, are my favorite, but I love Velo programs because it's exercise science. I get to use my knowledge, I get to use and change and do little things different and kind of do some trial and error and a little other things. And there's a foundation that I do. I'd say it's about 75% the same, but obviously, as you know, like for me, I believe as a coach is like, if you're doing the same thing, like we used to joke about certain coaches, and you know who I'm going to talk about here in a minute, but we won't mention his name, but you don't want to coach the same year 30 years in a row. We want to make sure that we're a different cat, we're a different coach, we're a different friend, you know, different influence. Make sure that we're growing constantly. And for me, I try to carry that over. Actually, I do carry that over into our developmental programs, whether it's our Velo programs, our hitting programs, pitching programs, and so forth. But when's your guys' next Velo program going to be?
Yeah, so we're starting off our throwing program next week, actually. So in the summertime, we ran kind of the Florida Baseball Ranch style of the program. It was more for 4 to 6 weeks, kind of 5 days a week. So it was pretty taxing on the players. But in the summertime, they don't have school. They don't have other stuff going on. So they're able to be there on time and be having a perfect attendance, where now we're going to go 2 days a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays, for about 2 to 2.5 hours. We'll start off with, on our Tuesdays, our physical body assessments as well as our video assessments. So the baselines from the day one, and then we'll kind of just track it. We'll probably go 6 to 8 weeks as well, just to kind of track and see their progress. Big thing that, just kind of talking like you were saying before, is there are some things that kind of we took out of the program that we used in the summer, and there's some new things that we added that we think can benefit some more of the guys. So the average age in that class, just kind of looking at the numbers, is going to be at 14 to 16 range. So it's going to be fun to kind of work with these guys that maybe they're not necessarily playing this fall, but they don't want to just completely shut down and not pick up a baseball until December, which I enjoy to see. And I think they're going to see a huge benefit factor from that standpoint. But also another thing we'll be implementing with them, and we've talked about this before, is anytime you're training in a group, is the atmosphere and the culture and the camaraderie is just so awesome. And I'm so excited to get these new kids, because we have – I think out of the 12, there's 10 new ones that will be starting up with us. So they've never got to experience it before. They're probably going to come in a little nervous that first day. And then all of a sudden, it's just fun to see them kind of get together and pull for each other and compete against each other, and kind of that friendly competition, and always looking to see who's going to increase the most velocity, or who's going to get the strongest, or who's getting more on their long toss. So it's always fun. It's kind of like getting a new team in, basically, and you get to start all over and run it the way you want to run it. I think the cool thing that we both get to experience is we're kind of like – pro player development guys right now, where we get a new crop of athletes coming in and we run it the way we want to run it. And it's just, we can put our hands on certain things. If we see things aren't going the right way, we just change it up. But it's just so cool to see these kids kind of see where they start, and then that reaching that result in the end, and doing the before and afters on videos, as well as the running guns or the bullpens, and letting them see their numbers and their improvements. Because it's just like anything else. If I'm trying to lose weight, I need to check the scale to see if I'm actually losing weight. So same thing from a throwing standpoint. If I can feel like I'm throwing harder all I want, but until that radar gun says that I am, all right, now I can actually believe it and carry it over into the next season that we're going to do the throwing program. And I'm glad you hit on it. Well, we'll do another winter one as we get closer. That would be more 3 to 4 days a week in that December area to get these kids ready for like a preseason, to get them ready for their high school season. So we're getting ready to rank up down here, and then just getting these new kids in the door and seeing what they're all about, and try to teach them some new stuff that they don't know about right now. But with your throwing program, Sean, how many do you have in your class on average, as well as kind of what are their ages?
Yeah, so I don't take anybody under the age of 12 years old. And what I mean by 12 years old is if they're 12 getting ready to become a 13-year-old, they'd be basically a rising 13-year-old. And I have taken 11-year-olds before in the past, but I tell them from the get-go, it's like advanced 11-year-olds, I say, hey, you're not going to do a lot of this advanced throwings type of stuff. Like at that age, our focus is going to be to increase relative and absolute strength. We want to get a foundation. We want to make sure their body's moving correctly and stuff like that. So we do little things like that. And then obviously the older kids, like the 15, 16, 17-year-old kids, we could start doing a lot more stuff because they've been in the program for years. And this will be, let's see here, this will be the sixth year, going on the seventh year that we've done a Velo program at LT. And it started out really small. So I used to do, it was like 4 to 8 kids. And we used to do them for the first couple of times we did them. And it got bigger and bigger. And now we kind of cap it at 20 to 24, depending on the age groups. Also, depending on my my instructors that come and help out as well too, because I want to make sure that we're getting that group, that competitive, like, hey, this is a camaraderie atmosphere, just like you were talking about with the team and everybody, like, and you know this, like, every single kid that comes into that environment, that's the environment they want to be a part of. Like, and when parents actually see it, they're like, wow, like this is a learning environment. This is a competitive environment. Like, there's nothing like a guy that's running, gunning, and he's throwing 92 miles an hour and he's trying to get up to 93, 94, 95 or whatever. And then he hits that 95 and everybody just goes nuts and everybody's so pumped for him. And you can't recreate that environment. And they do the same thing for guys. Like, I had this, he's a freshman this year. He goes to a county school here in Kokomo, and he's increased over the, since the last Velo program, he's going to start the fall one. He increased like 13 miles an hour over the course of like one calendar year. And it was, I mean, like that's, for those that are listening, like, that's absolutely stupid. Like, that doesn't happen all the time. And we've had crazy numbers like that. But we want to make sure that, you know, we tell everybody from the get go, like, hey, an increase in velocity is not guaranteed. There's basically three factors that go into your increase in velocity. One is your strength and conditioning and nutrition, you know, and that including that nutrition includes your rest and stuff. So we want to make sure that we talk to them about that. We give packets to kids that do the strength and conditioning and nutrition type orientations with us. And then for the Velo program guys, we just talk about it and we kind of go over it. And I send them some PDFs online for them to kind of look over. One thing I'm actually going to do, because I get bombarded with this question so much, is I'm going to probably just put it on my website, like sample meal plans and sample, weight gainer shakes. Cause that's, yep. I ask it, I send it out all the time. From now on, I'm just going to say, send it to my website. So number two is your arm care and what you're doing day in and day out. And that's the thing is like a lot of people, we had Zach on last week, you know, this guy throws 99 miles an hour. His version of long toss is different than our version of long toss. Is he right and we're wrong, or vice versa? No, absolutely not. And like you mentioned it on the podcast, is everybody's different. And so one thing that we do, a foundation of our program, is throwing footballs and throwing long toss. And obviously at younger age groups, I will kind of condense their long toss. It'll be shorter. It won't be as long. And the older guys, we kind of expand it a little bit more. But I always tell them, like, hey, go out to where you're under control. Go out to where you're still mechanically efficient. Go out to where you're not flying open with the front side and you're not all over the place spinning off, coming off the side of the ball. And a lot of people are listening, are like, well, how do I know that? Well, where's the ball going in the cage? And we kind of say, we use the term stay in your lane in our programs. And it's like, we have this 5 foot strip of turf right in the middle of the cage. If you're flying all over the place and your stride is getting all the way across when you're doing either your running gun, or a basic crow hop, or we do like a pitcher's crow hop, pitcher's two-step crow hop too, that's a problem. And we want to make sure we're staying behind the ball. So, you know, aside from that, so to get back to the 3 points to increase velo, the third and final thing is the actual intent and dedication that clients have and when they're doing their stuff on their own. Because our fall velo program is 2 days a week. And we do it, it's like an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minutes. Now, I advertise it as it's like an hour long, but it's not really an hour long. There's a 15-minute pre-warm-up that everybody shows up and they get done. It's intense. Everybody hates it. 15 minutes. You know, we got to activate the CNS. We got to break a sweat. We got to get them, you know, get some activation drills going. And then the next 20 minutes after that, we're doing a more intense plane specific, sports specific, which, you know, I hate that word, but that's the way I say it. But to get them ready to throw, whether it's med ball stuff, band stuff. We do a ton of that med ball stuff, throwing the football. We use some plyo care balls and do some arm circles and certain things like that to keep the rotator cuff, keep the scap moving efficiently. And then we throw around and do obviously some, I have a speed day where we work on dynamic effort type training. And then we have a max effort / strength effort day. And I use that term loosely because we're not actually using barbells. We're using more sleds. We're using more heavy med balls one day, light med balls the next day. One focuses speed, one focuses power. So we do a lot of that stuff. And then we get into the actual throwing and the long toss part of it. And then afterward, we do the recovery. And people that are actually listening to this right now, a lot of the problem is people think that we just throw all the time. And as you know, like, that's the smallest part of our program. Like, the throwing, we honestly, if we're actually throwing, it's probably 15 to 20 minutes of the hour and a half that they're here. And we do so much of the recovery, doing so much of, hey, let's take care of these guys. Let's do the right things. Let's develop them the right way. And, you know, those are all broad terms that we're talking about. But, you know, that going back to number three, the intent is if I give you a sheet and this is what you're supposed to do on day three of the week, day four of the week, day five of the week, and you're not doing it, you know, as a parent, you're listening to this and you go, well, you know, I'm investing in a program. I want my kid to do it. I'm sitting here. I don't want to waste my time working with a kid that doesn't want to do stuff on his own. And that's the thing that people miss is sometimes people think, hey, just because I'm doing this program, I'm automatically going to be throwing 90 miles an hour. And that's not true. It's how dedicated are you to doing your work? How intent and, you know, actually doing the work, you know, people confuse activity with productivity constantly. Going through the motions, like a six sets of six on a squat in a weight room. And I use this example all the time. Like if I say, hey, we're going to do a six rep max today. There's a big difference between a guy that knows what he's doing and is actually pushing himself to his absolute limit versus a guy that's like, you know, this first three sets, I'm going to increase a little bit of weight here and there. And he wastes four or five sets and does one really hard set. And that's a problem. It's the same thing with throwing and arm care. And so those are kind of the three things that I always kind of talk about. And I obviously don't write them down. I just explain to him like, hey, this is how it is. This is how it's going to be. Like I could tell you about this guy who's gone from 85 to 95. I could tell you about this guy who's gone from 88 to 93. I could tell you about this guy who went from 78 to 90. Like we have a ton of examples like that, but we also have examples of guys that only increase, you know, a mile an hour or two, or they stay the same. And they, at the end of the day, they look like, oh man, I didn't do the velo. And if people don't understand, like velocity is a process. I mean, Zach Thompson on last week was just saying like, hey, like, you know, I worked and worked and worked and worked and my velo wasn't coming. All of a sudden one day it just clicked. And all of a sudden it came out. It's not a steady state. And people that are watching this right now, I'm basically looking at a graph. Like anybody that talks about success, you know, millionaires or successful people, it's not a steady state increase. You get a little better and then you have some adversity and you drop a little bit. You get a little better, you start rising the occasion, and then you have some adversity and drop a little bit. That's the same way with throwing. If everybody was in a constant state of increased throwing, we'd have dudes throwing 120 mile an hour yep. every single week on the MLB. But and that was kind of long-winded, but I love talking about that stuff. And it's stuff that I really enjoy because people ask that stuff all the time. They ask questions all the time. And for me, a lot of people are lazy in the fact that they don't want to just go do the research. They want the easy answer. And people that ask questions and they ask the same questions over and over, what they're really saying is, hey, give me an easy answer because I don't want to do what you told me to do. Mm-hmm. And that's something like, and I, at LT, we try to create that culture like, hey, no matter what we're doing, we're going to take the hard route. It's that it is what it is. Like there's one thing you can guarantee, it's accountability, discipline, and hard work. Those three things work in, not only are you going to become a better man, a better athlete, you're also going to get results. It might not happen next week. It might not happen next month. It might not happen a year from now, but 2 years, you're going to be a completely different person, or 3 years, you're going to be a completely different person, or so forth.
Yeah, and I'm so glad that you covered the basics of what you put in, you're going to get out of it, as well as if you're having perfect attendance versus coming every other day, as opposed to you need to be there every day, held accountable, doing your job, and actually working to get better at this stuff if you're serious about seeing some gains. So just based off our summer program, our biggest jump was 10 miles an hour, but the kid was 13 years old, but he worked out with the older kids. He showed up every single day. He never missed a day. When he threw with intent. When he worked out, it was with intent. Versus a guy that was saw the least, which was a 2 mile jump, but 2 mile per hour jump. But what it was there was probably a lot of times where, hey, when coach isn't looking, I'm going to take this rep off. And we're just not going to go around and make you do every single thing. You've got to learn how to work on your own. And that's what's another cool thing about being in the group is we have two coaches while we're running it, and we have 12 to 15 kids in there. But it's all eyes can't always be on you, and you've got to learn how to work on your own, because when you get to the high school level, you're going to have two coaches with about 25 kids on the roster. And then when you get to college – you have four coaches with about 35 to 40 kids on the roster. Mm-hmm. So if you want to get better, you've got to do this stuff on your own. So I'm so glad that you were able to hit that, where we don't stamp a guarantee of, hey, if you come join this program, we guarantee 6 miles an hour. No, and there's programs out there that will try to say that, and it's complete BS, because you can't guarantee anything. Yep. You don't know how hard the kid's going to work, and you don't know when it's going to come. Like Zach was talking about last week, it might be one day just pops up out of nowhere and bang, there's 5 miles an hour. When you grew, you got stronger, and all this stuff just finally started to click together. So I'm glad that you covered that standpoint.
Absolutely. And, you know, and we tell people, we're like, hey, the average mile an hour increase, you know, has been 3 mile an hours in this camp. We did 4 mile an hour this camp. And so people see that and they go, wait a minute, I'm going to increase 4 mile an hour? No, dude, that's the average. Like, we got guys that increase higher than that. We got guys that are below that. We got guys in the middle, and that's what gives us our average. And you can immediately tell the guys that have the highest increases, either one, they started at a lower level and increased and got to that higher level, or two, they're working hard and they actually put in the effort, put in the work, but also understood, like, you got to work smart too. You know, there's a kid in my program right now who is, I want to say he was complaining. He's just upset about his velocity being a little down. And I asked him, I kind of got some more detail about it. And I found out that he was throwing three times a weekend for his summer travel team.
Oh yeah.
And so like he would throw 80 pitches, the next day he'd close a game. And then the next day after that, he'd rest. And then he'd start again on the Sunday. And I'm like, dude, like you got dead arm. Like your coach is overthrowing you. Like you're not where you want to be at because you're not getting your recovery. You're not eating right. You're not getting your rest. You know, it's hard to do any kind of arm care when you're throwing off the bump every single day. And that's the thing is like, yes, I'm a firm believer that we need to make sure that we throw and we're constantly throwing. It's like lifting weights. We don't stop just because we're sore, but we also have to understand intensity. We have to understand what the stimulus is. We have to understand what we're doing, how we're doing it, and why we're doing it. And that's something that's lost on a lot of people.
And that goes back into a couple episodes ago when we talked about how to pick the right coach for you. And it goes back to communication, where you've got to be able to tell your coach, this is exactly what I'm doing on the weekend. So what do I need to do to kind of have myself ready for it? If I'm in season, out of season, it just all goes back to the biggest thing that's missed a lot in this world is just communication.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, there's one thing I kind of want to talk about, and this is something that annoys me. So it's something that's asked a lot. And I know we've talked about it a lot, and you've been doing it for a long time too. So I get this question all the time, like, hey, you know, what do you have a softball hitting instructor, or is it a softball? The softball swing is different than the baseball swing. And we've been telling people for years now, and most of the LT people already know this, but there's a lot of people that are fresh into asking, like, hey, like, we want to start hitting lessons. Can you explain to the listeners and, you know, why there is not a difference between the softball and the baseball swing, and why an elite swing path is an elite swing path, period?
And that kind of just goes back to Mythbusters, basically. So, I mean, probably when we were coming up, we would have totally thought there's a softball swing and there's a baseball swing, and you either do one or the other. You don't mix them together. And then I would probably say within the past 7 years, maybe, you start to see Oklahoma, Alabama, LSU, these teams start to tinker around with some stuff. Like, hey, wait, our fields are 200 feet, 220 feet. Why are we not teaching our girls how to launch the baseball just like they launch them in baseball, and just like they launch the baseball? So let's teach them in softball standpoint. And so it's the same swing. And that's what we tell everybody when you walk through the door is, when you come here, it's a swing. It's not baseball. It's not softball. We're developing a swing that tries to suit you the best. Now, if you're 105 pounds, you probably don't need to be trying to launch the softball. Maybe you'll play a different game. But at the same time, what we're not going to do is we don't teach slap hitting. I know before we came on, you mentioned some people have asked, hey, do you work with slap hitters? And no, we just work on hitting the baseball or hitting the softball hard consistently. And so going to the standpoint is, if you can put the best softball girl, whoever the best hitter is, and compare them to Mike Trout, you're going to see so many similarities in a swing. And the only really difference that stands out to me is in the softball world, they have the rise ball, which now you're seeing in baseball, where these four seamers up in the zone are starting to attack some hitters that maybe have more of a slight up swing to their swing. So they're having to learn to stay off that pitch. So now it's, hey, we're going to get so worried about the high ball that we just, hey, we're not going to swing like that. No, learn how to drive the softball just like you would learn how to drive the baseball. You're going to do a lot of the same kinematic sequence of hips, hands, torso, arms, all that working in together. And then you're going to do a lot of the same drills, exercises. Literally, the only difference is when we're working on softball is we're flipping underhand as opposed to throwing batting practice overhand. So I'm glad that you were able to bring that up, because I think that is such a big thing of, like, we're called the High School Heat Baseball Academy. So people assume, hey, do you work with softball players? We have about 10 that come through here. One of our best hitters is a softball hitter. Her name's Haley. She's probably going to hit 20 home runs this season in high school. She's a senior, and she's already got a junior college scholarship down in Florida that she's going to go attend. And one more thing to hit on is, it was probably about a month ago, I had a good conversation with Patrick Murphy, the head coach at University of Alabama softball. They've been a power. They've won a national championship. They're always in the top 10. And he was calling to pick my brain about hitting, about different drills, about philosophies. And it was just so cool that he even admitted, like, hey, if I think you can help me, I'm going to call and I'm going to try to pick your brain to see if I can pick something up on you. And it wasn't that he called some big softball instructor. No, he called a guy that played baseball and that posted about baseball. And hey, it's all the same exact thing going on to it. So what is kind of your philosophy, like, when somebody walks in at LT and they're asking, like, hey, do I hit with Sean or do I hit with, like, the softball girl, since she played softball?
Yep. And so, and that's one thing is like, we have a new softball pitching instructor, and we've already been asked a couple of times about, does she do hitting? And my response is actually, you know, she hit back in the day, but her pitching was her thing. But if you're wanting hitting, like, you come to one of our hitting instructors. And I always, so I'll start with an example of a girl that is now playing college softball that came to us. This was like 4 years ago, and it was her junior year. She had a lot of hip drift, a lot of gliding in her swing, hands dragged behind, a lot of downward swing angle. And she was, you know, slice the ball down. And she's like, you know, I want to hit for more power. And, you know, her brother actually is in the program too. And that's kind of how it got correlated. And she had never hit any home runs. And she put a full off season in, you know, hitting once a week and being consistent there. And we talked about, you know, being on plane with the baseball, having that, you know, I always talk about that level to slight upswing in the zone, understanding where the pitches are and how to attack them, and understanding and reading them. And she ends up hitting 11 home runs and sets her high school record for home runs the next year. And she absolutely tore it up. And she actually still hits with me to this day when she comes home from college. And she'd be the first one to admit, like, you know, hey, like, they weren't trying to hurt my swing. It's just they were teaching what they were taught. Mm-hmm. And that's things like you said, the last 6-7 years, things have changed a lot and people have kind of broke it down. Like you see, I can't remember the Georgia girl, cause the Georgia softball team is legit, but they would put side by side on social media of her and Albert Pujols and how they literally look exactly the same. And Albert Pujols is arguably a top five hitter of all time. And, you know, like you're talking about the sequence of everything firing from the ground up, you know, in the hips, the torso, the hands, and then the barrel coming through. Like, all of those things are exactly the same. And I did read a statistic too, and the majority of the rise balls, by the time they get to the plate, they're out of the zone. So a lot of that too is about recognizing the pitch, understanding, hey, I'm not going to chase pitches out of the zone. It's the same thing with like us and sliders. As you know, like, it took me a while to figure out how to hit sliders and lay off certain sliders. And, you know, it's a lot of things is pitch recognition, knowing your role, because like you said before, there's going to be certain girls that are going to be a little bit different. They're not going to be trying to hit bombs all over the place. But, you know, there's a lot of girls that are very athletic. Girls are athletic in the game of softball. And it's a 200 to 220 foot fence. You know, if I can make a big difference with my team and hitting the ball and driving the ball in the gaps and hitting the ball over the fence, that's something we need to take advantage of. And it's something that's definitely overlooked. But that's kind of how I run through and I kind of break up down the example. And then I break down a little bit of the science behind it. Cause I always want to talk on, you know, the level of the client. I want to explain things to them. I don't want to, you know, even though in my head I'm like, oh, here we go. Another person thinks the softball swing is different than the baseball swing. You know, I try obviously not to come across that way, but I try to answer it as detailed and clear as possible. And it's up to them if they want to make the decision. And more often than not, obviously they come and sign up. We got like 7 girls in the program right now. And they tear it up. And we got this one young girl who I think is going to end up being an absolute superstar when she gets older too. But it's definitely something that's asked constantly and we talk about constantly. And for those that are listening, like, you know, you can look it up yourself and you don't have to take our word for it. You can easily find some videos and people breaking it down and talking about the swing being the same.
And props to girls, because every girl that I have worked with, their attention to detail is so on point, where maybe I know they'll say, and they mature faster than boys do. So like, just say there's a 14-year-old girl and a 14-year-old boy, that 14-year-old girl seems to pick this stuff up even faster than that 14-year-old boy. And we've talked about it before. I think it's a standpoint of, they don't want to feel like they're letting us down, but they're also, hey, this coach is telling me to try this, so heck, I'm going to try it. Whereas sometimes maybe the ego side of a male or the boy is going to be like, I'm going to keep doing it my way, versus, hey, I'm really going to try this and buy into it. So props to the girls that have bought into it. And I think they're reaping all the success from it.
Yep. I always say this, and I say it on purpose to a lot of the guys, but the girls always, on average, and I say the majority of the time, I guess, the girls will always work harder than the guys. They always do. And it's a certain mentality. It's like you said, girls have the, if they trust you, young women, if they trust you and they believe what you're doing, they'll do everything they possibly can to implement exactly what you're saying. And like you said, like, sometimes the male ego gets in the way with a lot of things. And it's like, well, this has always helped in the past. Like, you know, this is what I'm going to continue to do. And they get a little resistant. And what I've noticed is like, hey, they're more of an open book. Like, hey, I'm willing to get better. I'm willing to do these things. And not only that, it's just an effort thing. And, you know, people are listening, like, you know, intrinsically, like, you know, I won't get into, I don't want to be, you know, political about it, but, you know, women and men are obviously different in a lot of ways. And one thing about women, I've been around women that work their butts off their whole life. And that's one thing I noticed in the softball world is they work absolutely all the time. And softball mm-hmm. seasons, like, they're playing all the time, like the amount of effort. And, you know, sometimes like, oh man, this summer went by hard, and the softball girls got like 5 more weeks left in their summer. Oh, yeah. So
playing 10 games on a weekend too.
Mm-hmm. They get after it, man. And I'm like, whew, man. And I got 2 girls, so I'm probably not too far behind from that life. So,
oh yeah, it will start soon.
Yeah, absolutely. But you know, another thing that that is kind of talked about a lot, and we've touched on this before, and trying to create that competitive atmosphere, we talked about a little bit before. You know, when people come to see you now, and I know that you kind of run your lessons a little bit different than us, but kind of similar at the same time. You know, what's your views on private instruction, like in private instruction versus semi-private and group training? Like, how do you feel about those?
Yeah, so when we first started, we were doing the basic, the one-on-one instruction, just because that was kind of the popular thing, as well as that's what everybody else has always done. So it's, hey, don't steer too far from the past, because this has worked before. So we did it, and then it wasn't actually until me and you started reconnecting and talking again about how you have your semi-privates as well as your group training, and how much all the benefits you saw from it. And so props to you for doing that, because it really opened my eyes, as well as it's opened a lot of kids' eyes here as parents, and we're seeing so much success from it, because these kids are getting after it together. They're not so secluded to, hey, I have this full hour, me and the coach, and you're trying to be locked in on every little single swing, where they actually will get their breaks in between. They're watching the other athlete. They're learning from the other athlete. Maybe they don't have to do the same thing that they have to do, but it's, hey, if I ever start to struggle, I know that he was telling this guy to work with this, so that's what I'm going to go to. As well as they build cool relationships. They start to schedule their own times together of, hey, when you want to come hit next week, and just, we've seen so many great results from going. We go about 1:15 now. We run them through a warm-up together. Then we started with our routine of whatever their drills are they like to do on their own, and then we jump into some competition at the end of them two facing off against each other, whether it's a hard hit game or a 2-strike game, or hey, we're going to hit off the hack attack, and whoever can hit the 10 most line drives is going to be the victor. And so you're seeing the competitive nature take over to what's ultimately going to happen in that ball game. And I think so many of the one-on-ones have just created this, well, it's all about me standpoint, that maybe they're not translating that to the field as well, because they don't have the coach in their ear telling them exactly what's going on. Because I tell all of our athletes here is, unfortunately, we're not going to be at their ball games. Like, they have to be their own hitting coach at that standpoint. And if they're so used to us and hearing our voice saying it over and over again that they forget, or then they're just lost out there in the middle of nowhere. And then they'll come back in saying, hey, it wasn't my best weekend. Well, what happened? Well, I just forgot everything that we had worked on. Well, then we're just starting all over again every time you come in. So we've got to get to that point of, hey, what'd you work on last week? What do we figure out works for you? What is kind of your routine? And I think that's the coolest thing, is like having two hitters at one time. One guy loves to do one hand drills. The other guy hates it. Well, guess what? He doesn't have to do it. If he doesn't think that helps him in any way, the one hand guy is going to do his thing, and then the guy on the side, he'll do his thing. So it's just kind of letting them build their own routine and leading off into a bigger picture. When they get to high school, they kind of know what works for them. And so when they're in the cage with the kids and there's no coach down there and they're flipping to each other and stuff, they're not going to just be horsing around, because they know exactly what they need to do. So just for us implementing the semi-private and the group training, that's the direction we're going in from here on out. I think we're going to leave everybody in the dust that's still stuck in the one-on-one ways, from a standpoint of, hey, you're going to get left behind, because these one-on-ones are just taking away from so much of just building themselves up and building confidence and all this other stuff that comes with it. So sometimes they need to leave. We talked about it before. They need to leave not having the best day, knowing like, hey, it wasn't my best day today, but I'm going to work on it to get better. Or maybe they were exhausted when they came in the door, and that's why it wasn't their best day. But it helps them understand, like, not every day you come in the cage, you're just going to look like Mike Trout. It rarely ever happens. And when it does happen, just thank the good Lord above that that day was your day, because the next day you come in, it's going to humble you real fast and get you right back down in the same spot you were in before. But I can't stress the guys enough. And for those parents and kids that are listening, is if you are still doing the one-on-ones, approach your instructor or try the 2-on-1s, try 3-on-1s, try the private, the semi-privates, the small groups, and tell me that you won't get more out of that stuff. And it's not that we want to spend any less time with your athletes. It's just they need to learn. Number one, the breaks are so important. You can't expect the kid to come in for an hour and just bang 350 baseballs. Like, they're not going to get better, number one. But number two, like, there's no need in doing that. They're going to create bad habits. Also, their focus isn't going to be there because it's monotonous. It's the same thing over and over again. And then third, there's no competitive drive going. So when they get to that game and their heartbeat ramps up, and intensity ramps up, they're not ready for it. And so last night there was a great competition going on back and forth in the hack attack that one guy ended up being the victor. And it was like a, hey man, it was a big dap up, like, hey, I got you this week, but hey, the other guy's going to get you next week. So it's creating a friendly competitive environment, and that's what we're trying to build here. And that's the culture we've been building since, I guess, after quarantine had started. So
yeah,
like I said, props to you for kind of lighting us in on that situation. And I'm so glad that we changed. And even as myself and our instructors, like, we're so much more happier, and we're letting these kids grow, and it's not so much on us to like break down every single swing, because we were getting caught into every little single swing. We're so locked in and focused. We'd live here at night just mentally drained and exhausted because like, we're just having to worry about one swing at a time. So
yeah,
it just helps them understand, man. And like, if you want to have two kids, one's feeding off the hack attack while the other one's hitting, if you're working with another guy, if you want video done, hey, you're going to come video while this one's hitting. It just helps out all around, where it's like a team effort versus just little Johnny and the coach getting after it on a bucket of balls while he just flips to you for an hour. So if you've never tried it before, I highly suggest you trying it. And just, I think everybody's going to see the good results. And last, since we've went to it, we've had two parents that just said, hey, this isn't for us. We just really enjoyed the one-on-one stuff. And we told them, okay, that's perfectly fine. Well, one of them has recently already came back into the program, and they're still doing the two-on-one stuff. And the other one just kind of went about their way just because they weren't ready to take their kids to that next level. In my opinion, they're holding them back. So I think later on, the kid's going to realize, like, dang it, I wish I would have done that, as opposed to letting my parents kind of take over and just keeping me private to themselves. Mm-hmm. But that's, yeah, my whole rant about it. Yeah, what's kind of your philosophy? I know what you guys got going on there, but for those listeners that don't know, is kind of just describe, like, it's like the culture, like when those kids are coming in there together, and just how everything and the enthusiasm and how it breeds off each other.
Yeah, so we do most of our lessons are three-on-one lessons. So it's one coach and three athletes. Certain age groups or certain kids that are just getting introduced to the program, like, you know, we'd like to, if we have the availability, we'd like to do a consultation and assessment and kind of see where they're at. And it allows us and helps us kind of to where we can put them at physically. Like, you know, if I'm going to put this advanced 12-year-old, if he's an advanced 12-year-old, I would like to be him to be around some 14, 15-year-olds and have that competitive atmosphere. If we have somebody that's a little bit behind their age, maybe they're going to be with some younger guys and they've got to play catch up. But we will put together the guys based on a lot of talent level, based on the effort level, based on, you know, discipline. And I can't stress enough, like, in the beginning, like a long time ago, years and years and years ago, we would do one-on-ones, and, you know, I'm going to piss some people off right here, and that's fine, 'cause I don't care. It is what it is. If you do one-on-ones, you get results. Cool. That, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, I've done well over 12,000 hours of lessons now at this point in time. And I'm very confident in what we do and how we do it, just like I know you are. There is nothing like the atmosphere when three guys that have been hitting with each other for a while and they're coming in for a lesson and they're excited, they're energetic, they're ready to rock and roll. And it is just a complete next level atmosphere, especially when you create that competitive environment. Like, hey, this is live round. We're going to go 4 ABs right here. Who's going to go 3 for 4? Who's going to go 4 for 4? Who's going to go 2 for 4? Whatever, you know, that environment, you can't create that environment in a one-on-one at private atmosphere. And to me, one-on-one private training it creates entitled kids. And there's a lot of entitlement in the world with, you know, a lot of areas in life, all areas in life. And there's a certain type of dad or a certain type of mom that asks for private instruction. And now at this point in time at Laird's Training, like, everybody pretty much knows around the area how we train kids. So I never had this question at all, but I rarely have this question. But people say, you know, my kid, I'm going to tell you right now, this is a red flag, parent. So if you say this, my kid just needs a little bit more attention. He just doesn't understand things. Like, he needs you to have, like, explain it in more detail. So what you're saying is I need to get the baby wipes. I need to wipe his ass and I need to take care of him is what you're saying. Like, I'm going to hold his hand and go, hey, sweetie, it's going to be okay. That's not how I'm going to be. And that's not how I'm going to act. I'm never going to be like that. And when you create that type of environment and when you say those things, you're showing your cards as a parent, like, hey, like, what they're really saying is, hey, we should be treated differently. We should be treated special. My son should be treated special. You know, whether the parent makes a lot of money or whether they, you know, and money's not a big deal to them, or they just think that their kid is the kid of all kids, they think they need special treatment. And I completely disagree with that. And this is why I say that. You can have, and everybody knows what a 5 o'clock hitter is that plays in baseball. 5 o'clock hitter is a guy that can absolutely hammer in BP, look really good in the cage. He can't transfer it to the game. And so what I like to say is there's a guy in the one-on-one atmosphere. You can control the stimulus. You can control the environment. You can say, hey, this is all right. You're comfortable. You're relaxed. You know what you're trying to, you know what you're expecting. Kids don't need that. Kids need to feel insecure. They need to feel like they're not good enough. They need to feel, and people are like, what the hell? That's what you're saying. Yeah, they need to feel that way. They need to have confidence in themselves. But confidence is not something that you're born with. It's not something that you just all of a sudden have. It's something, it's a skill. It's a, you acquire it over time. And like, there's like, when you get those young kids in the weight room or those young kids in a hitting session that are, they're in the group, but this say player one and player two are next level and the other guy's just a solid hitter. He needs to be like, oh my, like this dude's hitting this ball 95 mile an hour off the tee every swing. Like, this is crazy. I'm hitting the ball 80. Like, that's a problem. Like, and they need to be like, I'm not on that guy's level. I need to compete with that level. And when you create that one-on-one environment, it's a lax environment. It's smooth. And like you said, you have to pace it. Like, if you're, you know, there's a lot of guys around in the internet that they'll offer $60 for half hour sessions, $120 for 1 hour sessions. Is that's kind of like a normal rate for a lot of guys with good expertise in hitting and stuff. And for me, it's like, I can't stand the type of environment that you're not going to have on the field. Like, why are we practicing in an environment where kids are in one by themselves when they're going to be around other people and have to communicate and have these, you know, interpersonal skills for the rest of their life? And that's something that people miss on, is like, it's not, we're not just teaching how to swing a bat. We're not just teaching how to adjust to a curveball. We're not just teaching, you know, reading pitches and understanding the counts and situations. We're teaching your son how to be confident in himself. We're teaching your son that, hey, it's okay to not be where you want to be or be where you think you are, but you got to put in the work to do it. Cause look at this guy that's in your group. He's out there kicking ass and taking names. You know, he's way ahead of you. You're the same age. And there's a guy in my program right now that just started. Awesome kid. I'm really excited about him, but he's a sophomore in high school and he only weighs 115 pounds. Mm-hmm. And no offense, obviously. And he would know this and wouldn't be offended at this, but like, that's, we can't be at that weight and compete at a high level at that age. And we got to make sure that we're getting these guys uncomfortable, but you know, the old adage of, hey, you got to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. But so many people get lost on the fact that they think that they need special treatment or special work. And it's the furthest thing from the truth. Cause I see it's a certain type of person, a certain type of kid. They can't rely on a coach to constantly be on them. And I love the stations because they have a station with me. They have a station, off to the side that I can see and I can watch them like, hey, this is our drill today. This kid, you're going to do it like this. You're going to do this drill because you're having trouble. Maybe he's slapping at the ball. His top hand's negative. So we're going to work on flattening the swing out. Different drills. So I could sit there and we're tossing and I can look over at him. Now there's accountability. Like, he's doing this drill on his own. And this is something that is, this is the biggest miss in hitting lessons for those that are listening, is people think I'll teach a drill or a coach will teach a drill. And I'm saying, hey, this is your homework. You're doing this on your own. And then they go home and they say they've done this drill. And this happens all the time. I'm like, okay, well, show me. And then I watch them in the cage and they're terrible at it. They're not doing it right. And like, well, I was doing it so good before. And I go, well, no, like in your eyes and in the lens that you were, your perspective, you were, but I'm telling you right now, you're doing this. We got to do this better. This is wrong. And when we have that environment, and I can sit there and I can watch the kid hitting on his own, because we rotate, it's like every 5 to 10 minutes in the cages. And I look over and I see him doing something wrong. I'll stop with the kid that I'm currently working. I'll go and go, hey, you're doing this incorrect. So he's getting corrected in the middle of the lesson, even though he's not in the same cage with me. He's in the cage next to me. Now he understands, hey, I need to fix this. And that's, I always say the most important station is their personal drill station. It's something that they need to work on and get better at. And the reason is that if they could do that right in that cage, I know and I have confidence they're going to do it right when they're on their own now. And that's the thing, is of course they're going to do it. Well, they're going to try to do it right when they're in the cage with us, right? And we're doing certain things. And I say this, like, I'm within, you know, 20, 30 feet of the guys constantly. And then we have a strength and power station where we're working on development, grip strength, rotational power, stuff I've talked about before. But when you have accountability in those semi-private sessions, you're teaching these kids to do these things on their own. You're teaching these kids not just to do the things, like go back to the productivity versus activity. Now we're teaching them to do it the right way. You're holding them accountable to do it on their own the right way. And then sometimes I'll say, all right, you're going to do this drill off the tee or on the jug soft toss machine. And then you're going to come here and do the same drill. Let's see how well you do it. Let's see how it transfers into the ball when the ball's coming at you. And I can't stress it enough. Like, I've done it for a long period of time. And I had always offered semi-private training. And I, like, years ago when I offered semi-private and the private, the results that I saw from the guys in the semi-private versus the private were night and day. The confidence levels, the competitive nature, understanding things. Because this is another thing that's missed upon is they get to learn other kids' swings. Like, this kid's swing's not like mine, right? This kid's not like me. This kid has a different personality. This kid understands, like, hey, his approach on a curveball or his approach on a fastball is different than my approach. Well, why is it different? You know, what are his strengths and weaknesses versus my strengths and weaknesses? And they're understanding and they're learning the game at a completely different level when they're in that environment. And I will, to the day I die, I will sit there and say that that's what kids need. They need to feel uncomfortable. They need to be pressed into that uncomfortable spot in their life or uncomfortable spot during the lesson. And when you conquer that uncomfortableness and you conquer those little adversities, that's where your confidence comes from. And that's where, you know, that mental toughness comes from. And people hear me talk about that. And there's a lot of people that are listening right now that go, hell yeah, I know exactly what he's talking about. And there's other people that don't know. And you don't know what you don't know because you haven't taken that road in life. But that's something that I will talk about. And I kind of got into a little bit more mental toughness talk there right there. But that's something. And I was talking to a buddy about it the other day about his son needs that environment. And he's in that environment, you know, a lot. But if you're around other kids that are – if your son has friends that are entitled, that are pampered, you are the sum of the five that you spend the most of your time with. Mm-hmm. And I spend – actually, and a lot of parents will say this, I spend more time with a lot of their kids than they spend with their own kids themselves.
Yeah.
And I want to be that example, and I want to put them in that group and that example. If I see a kid that needs some more mental toughness, I'm going to put them in with two dudes that I'd go to war with. Right. Mm-hmm. As long as they're similar in a lot of abilities. And that's going to help that kid far more than me doing a half hour or an hour long private lesson and, you know, trying to hold his hand throughout the process. But that's kind of my two cents with it.
Yeah. And I'm so glad that you hit on the mental toughness standpoint, because we always talk about how when you come to hitting lessons, whether it's at LT or here at the Heat, is you're getting so much more than just actual hitting lessons. You're getting a game plan. You're getting mental toughness built in. You're getting strength and conditioning. You're getting accountability. You're building all that stuff. It's not, we're just coming in and teach you the best swing mechanics that we think are possible. And I think that's the thing that gets overlooked the most. And when we talk to hitters, what I tell a lot of our guys is I'm trying to create you to be your own hitting coach, because you know your body better than anybody else. You know what gets you out of a funk. You know what you need that day to get ready for a game. Not anybody else. Like, you have to learn that. And when you learn that, your game will just go to a whole new level. And the last thing I'll touch on is just in this game of baseball, it's the hardest thing to practice at game speed. Whether it's taking ground balls in the infield, whether it's reading fly balls off the bat in the outfield, whether it's hitting, everything mm-hmm. in such a controlled environment that when the game does happen, kids tend to freak out because they're not ready for live game speed. So if it's indoor the facility, you got to get after it for whether it's the velocity training, whether it's competition training where myself or Sean's trying to strike you out, whatever it is from that standpoint to make the game easier. Like I always tell the guys in here is if you just come in, relax, you never feel stress, you never sweat, it's just nice and easy, that's not getting you ready for the game. It'd be almost like Steph Curry not practicing three-pointers and all of a sudden in the game he wants to try to break out three-pointers. He's not physically ready to do that, and he's not going to be good at it. And so the more you can practice at game speed, like I said, whether it's ground balls, live off the bat, just all that stuff right there is going to help take yourself over to the next level in this game of baseball.
Absolutely. You know, you have to have that chaotic environment. If you have a controlled environment, you have somebody that has no adjustability in life. You have somebody that has no adjustability. We talk about a swing of adjustability too, being able to adjust the pitches. Like the same thing applies for the mental part of the game, you know, the emotional part of the game and the physical part of the game is I can't be a one track mind. I can't keep butting my head against the wall and trying to do the same thing over and over, expecting a different result. It's something that people talk about all the time. But so, Adam, before we close out, man, the, you know, when you're getting ready to start, and I was kind of want to ask this question earlier too, but is there kind of a shutdown period now that we mentioned the Velo program earlier? I wanted to ask this question earlier. Do you advise pitchers to kind of shut down at all for a certain amount of time at the end of the year after they get them playing?
Yeah, so I try to base it off just innings pitched from the summer. So if, say they had 35 to 40 innings pitched and they're not slated to play any summer, they're not planning in the fall, they're just going to play again once the school season starts. So from that standpoint, it's, hey, shut it down from a standpoint of being on the mound, doing bullpen, stuff like that. And let's get your body back in shape, get your legs back under you, because you're going to be a little weaker just from playing the summer schedule. And then we start to add in the throwing stuff. And I'm so glad earlier that you hit on with the throwing program is it's not – you don't come in here just throw for an hour straight. You literally are learning how to move. You're building strength, your mobility, your scap enhancers, all the stuff that's going into it. And then you throw for 15, maybe 10 to 15 minutes. Or if it's, hey, I'm trying to develop a little cleaner arm path. Okay, so you might do some weighted ball stuff just to try to create that arm path from that standpoint. But if you're kind of done for the season right now and you don't plan on pitching off a mound or pitching in a game until, let's say, February 20th, is now's the time to get the body right. Let your arm rest if you need it. Like we always say, is know what your body is. Max Scherzer takes zero time off, and some guys will take 3 months off and then just pick it back up again. And then start that, hey, the long toss phase or the throwing velocity phase, whatever it is you're really trying to improve on. And if you're wanting to still hang on to your pitches, because some pitchers will be like, well, coach, if I don't throw my breaking ball or my changeup or my cutter, whatever it is from that standpoint, I'm going to lose the feel for it. All right, so now when you do your long toss sessions, when you work it back into 60 feet, that's where you can do your touch of feel still. You're not snapping off hammers left and right, but you're making sure that you still have the grip, the feel of that breaking ball coming off your fingers or the slider or whatever it is you throw. And then as you start to get ready to go, say, December, maybe November, December, all right, let's start getting back in on our bullpens. And it starts off with our bullpens of 15 to 20 pitches, and then it goes 25 to 30, and then you just slowly start to ramp it up to make sure you're ready to hit the ground running when the coach says you can have your first practice. February 1st, I believe, is the first day of practice for high school season down here in Mobile. And so it's just building a game plan together. And then on the other side of that is if you are playing a fall season and you just came off of summer, is you can't completely put the ball down because you're going to lose everything that you've built up. Mm-hmm. Maybe let's back it down a little bit to where, hey, I'm going to do a bullpen once a week and I'm going to get some long toss in or play catch 3 days out of the week. And just know what we kind of tell our pitchers here is just let your arm and let your body be the feedback. If you just had a great day of long toss yesterday and you're tired the next day, that's normal. Okay, so let's just play light catch. And then if you feel like you can ramp it up a little bit, go ahead and do that. But let your body tell you what you can and can't do. Now, don't get that confused with, like we talked about, with being sore and then actually being injured, because now if there's sharp pain or something like that going on, then that's where we've got to go do something different. But that's kind of our philosophy here with the guys that are coming off the summer season. Just based off of how much they threw, when they threw. We have a kid coming in tomorrow night throwing live to some hitters. He's kind of in – he didn't play much this summer. I think he's playing this fall, so he's kind of getting ramped up to get ready for that fall season. So he'll come in and face some hitters. I would probably say 45 to 55 pitches tomorrow night. So that's going to be fun to see that everybody's just kind of in different stages, and it all goes back to we don't cookie cut anybody. Everybody is built different, moves different, and they have different stuff going on. So whatever it is from that standpoint, just figure out a game plan that works best for you. One thing I'm a big believer in is printing your goals out and putting them on the wall where you can see them every single day. There's a catcher in here that his goal is to play at Florida State. He's 15 years old. I said, all right, what do we need to do to get you to Florida State? All right, let's look at different stuff. So, all right, so your pop time, it needs to be 1.9 or lower from a showcase standpoint. In game, 2.0 or lower. All right, your next standpoint, you need to – exit velo needs to be 92 or higher. All right, then your average distance needs to be this. Your batting average needs to be this. Your power numbers need to be this. And literally you look at this stuff every single day knowing, am I doing myself any favors to try to get there, or are these just wishful dreams that I'm looking at, but I'm not working towards them at all? And so and he's one kid that I know he looks at him every single day and he's putting a game plan together. And the cool thing is he still plays football too. So this isn't a guy that's just dedicated to baseball only. He's making time out of his day and whatever time he has available during the week to do the extra stuff. That way he doesn't get behind in the game of baseball. But what's kind of your philosophy with the guys? Does it all just depend on what part of the season they're in? And do you have them do like a shutdown mode, or what is it from that standpoint?
Yeah, absolutely. And that was really good stuff right there, especially at this point in time of the year. And, you know, what I usually do is, you know, this summer was weird, obviously, with COVID and everything. And I had a couple of kids that were, you know, really sore, abnormally sore, like they're not used to. And so I kind of use the 48-hour to 72-hour rule. Like sometimes, like, hey, you need 2 days off. And this is if you're in season. Like sometimes, like my big thing is like, we're 6 days on, 1 day off. And what I mean by 1 day off is you're still doing all your arm care, you're still doing all your bands, all that other stuff. But you could still light toss on your quote unquote day off. You could still do things like that. And that's one thing that people kind of like, oh, I'm an off day, you know, that doesn't mean you don't do anything. But like at the end of the season, like, especially like you hit it on the nose, like there in August, like we don't just stop. We kind of just drop the volume down a little bit. We give ourselves a little bit time to recover the season. If you're playing fall ball, which, up here, like for me, my philosophy on fall balls, you should be playing another sport or taking advantage of lifting weights and getting bigger, faster, stronger. And I kind of want to, well, in a future episode, we're going to talk about multi-sport athletes, and we're going to talk about strength and conditioning and stuff like that a little bit more too, kind of to add on to our strength and conditioning episode from a few weeks ago. But like we bring it down, maybe they're not throwing as many days in the week, and then they build back up again. They kind of ramp up toward fall ball again. And then after fall ball, I tell them to kind of take, hey, let's just take about 6 to 8 weeks off of throwing. And Cressy kind of is a big believer of like, you know, we get really super mobile. We get in a big external rotation over the summer, and he kind of likes things to kind of tighten back up again for 6 to 8 weeks off. Again, this is just something he believes in. I kind of like the idea of 6 to 8 weeks off because it, you know, gets them away from the ball and they can focus some other things, and then they build back up into it. So that 6 to 8 weeks off is usually just, you know, November and then like 2 weeks of December, and then they're back into it. And that's kind of the philosophy. If some people don't like doing it, like if they want to do pitching lessons and they're throwing just a few times a week over that period of time, that's perfectly fine as well. And just like you were saying, you know, everybody's a little bit different. Everybody can adjust to their bodies and know what their bodies are. Like the kid the other day that I was just mentioning, you know, his velocity was 4 or 5 mile an hour down. And I told him, like, dude, you need a break. We're going to take 2 weeks off. I don't want you to touch a ball for 2 weeks. Just relax. We'll build you back up. He's actually doing the Velo program as well. And then I'll give an update on the podcast of where he is here in about 4 or 5 weeks. But he's been overused and abused by his coach. And he just needed some time off, which is unfortunate. And we talk about it all the time. And, you know, with all the knowledge around nowadays, it's really crazy that still gets done at these levels. But, you know, it is what it is. But is there anything else you want to kind of jump on, Adam, or talk about before we roll out?
Yeah, last thing, just like kind of what you hit on there at the end is if you're noticing a drop in velo, or you're noticing a drop in exit velo, or you're noticing slower times or taking longer to recover, or you're not lifting as much as you were before, your body's telling you something. It's telling you you need that break. And so we always say the work smarter, not harder standpoint is there's times that you need that break, and let that be your feedback. Maybe you're not getting enough sleep at night. Maybe your nutrition isn't where it needs to be, but use that stuff to kind of gauge, hey, what's going on with my body? Because there's something going on that's not working right now.
Absolutely. And that's the thing, like you're eating Twinkies and ding dongs and you're getting 6 hours of sleep playing video games all night. Yeah, it might have a little something to do with your legs not being underneath you when you're throwing in a game.
Yep.
But absolutely. Well, guys, I hope you guys really enjoyed this episode. There's a lot of facts, a lot of good stuff on here. Adam, you know, dropped some knowledge bombs on us, and I'm really glad that he got to jump in and talk about that baseball versus softball swing and dropping a lot of knowledge on his throwing programs. But make sure you guys leave that 5-star review if you enjoyed the episode. And until next time, we'll see you guys later.